I'm doing a series that Jesus did weird stuff. He did normal Jesus stuff. Everybody wears those wristbands, or people have worn those wristbands. What would Jesus do? WWJD. And there's kind of a common expectation of what would be a Jesus-like thing to do. But as I got ready for the middle of our summer and knowing people are going to come and go, and some people will be here some weeks and not other weeks, it's just easier to have a series of a concept than it is to work through a book of scripture. When you miss a few of those, it's hard to keep track. And I came upon this idea of Jesus doing weird stuff. So every week is going to be different. Normally, I tell you the whole series up front, but I'm not doing that this time. You're going to have to come every week if you want to find out what the weird stuff is that Jesus did. Today is part two of a seven-part series, and it might actually become an eight-part series. It will depend upon what happens at the end of August. But today's sermon is titled, Don't Come With Me. A weird thing that Jesus did. Now, in order to set up the scripture, what I want to do is read some preliminary passages before we get to our main two-verse section, just to set the scene. Matthew chapter 4, verses 18 and 19. As Jesus was walking beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon called Peter, and his brother Andrew. They were casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. Come, follow me, Jesus said, and I will send you out to fish for people. At once they left their nets and followed him. That is a really Jesus thing. Follow Jesus. He just walks up to people that are at work. They're in their father's business. Come follow me. They drop their nets and follow him. Great story. Very Jesus-like. Matthew chapter 19, verses 20 and 21. All these laws and commandments I have kept since my youth, the man said, what do I still lack? Jesus answered, if you want to be perfect, go, sell all your possessions, give it all away to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me. Very Jesus-like answer, right? Isn't that what you expect Jesus to say? Sell everything, give it all away, stop your job, walk away, and come and follow me. Let's keep going. We're setting the scene here. When Jesus saw the crowd around him, he gave orders to cross over to the other side of the lake. Then a teacher of the law came to him and said, teacher, I will follow you wherever you go. Jesus replied, foxes have dens and birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. That sounds Jesus-like. Count the cost, figure out what you're going to do. Recognize that when you give up everything to follow me, that's what's going to be like. Luke chapter 9, verses 59 to 60. He said to another man, follow me. But he replied, Lord, let me go and bury my father first. Jesus said to him, let the dead bury their own dead, but you go and proclaim the kingdom of God. Very Jesus-like thing to say. I have to bury my father. Eh? Don't go to the funeral. Follow me and be a disciple. And I've heard these messages over and over and over where verses like this all the way through are applied to absolutely everyone. But Jesus did some weird stuff. And I don't know that I've ever heard a sermon on these two verses, the key verses for tonight. I don't think I ever have. And I've certainly never preached one because I put a little mark in my Bible for every passage I preach, and I have no bracket around this section. So in 42 years of preaching, well, 46, I've never preached on this passage before. The man from whom the demons, the legion of demons, had gone out of him into the pigs and they ran into the water and died. We're going to get to that one in a couple of weeks. When the man from whom the demons had gone out begged to go with him, but Jesus sent him away saying, "Return home and tell how much God has done for you." So the man went away and told all over town how much Jesus had done for him. What? Did you see that verse? The man begged to come with him. And Jesus said, "Nah. Not this time." Is something wrong with a guy? He had enough followers? It's just so odd that there seems to be this normal thing for Jesus to do, which is come follow me. And the word for come there is get up out of your seat, walk away from whatever you're doing. You have to love me more than you love father, mother, sister, brother, husband, wife, family. You can't keep your house. You have to walk away from your wealth. Those become the standard, normal Jesus things that almost everybody in the world believes. There's no debate about this. There's no equivalency. There's no shirking your duties and responsibilities. This is the absolute rule. Come, follow me, and you lose everything and you gain me. That's kind of the normal Jesus thing to do. And this guy, Jesus does something really weird. The guy begs him, he begs him to be able to go with him. And Jesus says, "I don't think so. I don't want you to come. I don't want you to follow me. I don't want you to leave where you are. I don't want you to get in my boat and join the 12 disciples and become a 13th disciple." Was there something wrong with the guy? I don't think so. It is that on occasion, Jesus really does weird stuff. He deals with each individual. The ones that he called as disciples were part of building a team that eventually was going to have the responsibility, certainly the privilege, but the responsibility of taking this emerging community called the church and exploding it. It was going to be overwhelming to them. And the 12 became the 11, then adding Matthias, the 12 became the central core of the church. But there was also 72 others that went out and you never hear from them again. There were people that were fed and Jesus said, "Okay, time to go home. Don't follow me. I want you to listen carefully to what I say, but your task is not to get up and walk away from everything. Your task is to stay and just describe what God has done for you." It's very, very interesting in Greek. The man says to him, it's an odd word. I'm pretty good in the New Testament Greek language. I had to look the word up that Matthew used or Luke used to describe what the man said in whatever language it was. But the word is a really odd construction. He says, it is really necessary for me to be with you, to stay with you, to abide in your presence. It is really important. Here's a guy who had had a legion of demons possessing him in such a way that they couldn't hold him with chains. He lived out in the cemetery. He kept bursting through all of the restraints. Everyone in town was terrified of him. His family didn't know what to do with him. He had no real means of support. He was ragged. He was nearly destroyed. And when Jesus encountered him, Jesus didn't speak to the man. He spoke to the demons in the man. And he cast them out into the pigs, and they ran headlong into the lake and drowned. And the man was restored. He was restored. He was healed. He was fixed. His brokenness, his demonic possession didn't destroy him. It had possessed him, but he was still different. And so the man has an appropriate response. Everyone in this town hates me. They're scared of what I do. I've ruined all of my relationships. I don't know where I'm going to go. They're not going to respond positively to what I've been through in these last few weeks or months or years. Please let me go with you. You're building a team. You're starting a movement. You're from the other side of the lake. I can go and get away from all this stuff. And Jesus says, no, don't come with me. Don't follow me. That's just like, really? I want you to stay here. I want you to tell what God has done for you. And here's this very interesting, you have to read pretty carefully to see this. Jesus says specifically to him, tell what God did for you. And the word is, tell the story. Just tell the story. It's your story. It doesn't matter whether it's bigger or smaller than anybody else or more spectacular or just commonplace. That doesn't matter. You have to make something up. When I was a young youth worker, there was an individual that became big, big time in the Christian world. His name was Mike Warnke. He was huge. His ministry was based in Versailles, Kentucky. The French people call it Versailles, but the people in Kentucky took that name for their village and called it Versailles. For real. Don't tell your husband. Versailles, Kentucky. And it was a worldwide ministry. He was a demon sorcerer, head of an occult thing, and he did all these wicked, horrible things and ate the bodies of dead cats and bats and blah, 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 blah. He made this gigantic story and became incredibly famous. And I heard him speak once. And he spent about 85 minutes out of a 90-minute message telling how horrible he was. And the last couple of minutes, how Jesus had saved him. A little tiny bit of Jesus, kind of at the end of this gigantic story. And as we as youth pastors struggled with, do we take our kids to hear Mike Warnke? They all loved him. I mean, the music was great and powerful, and his message was really scintillating, and just you were at the edge of your seat the whole time. We compared it to the Gerasene demoniac. A little bit of the tragic story and tell what God is doing. Describe God's power. Talk about God. It was very, very interesting. We found out years later, somebody who is not a Christian who had gone to the same high school as Mike Warnke, brought a yearbook to a national news media and said, here's a picture of Mike Warnke in my class. He was like a normal kid, a little quiet. He was part of the debate team. He wasn't some wizard in an occult movement. And that they began tracking what he said was his testimony, and none of it was true. None of it was true. The whole thing was fake. He argued, I gave glory to Jesus, and that's why I did it. The verb that's used here, what Jesus says, is just tell your story. It's not that it's so fantastic or so mesmerizing. You have a story. And what I want you to do is stay in your town, go to your family, go to your own people. They know where you've come from. They know who you are. Just tell your story. So when he went back to his town, the last verse, last section of the verse says, and he went throughout his town telling what Jesus had done for him. The instruction was, tell what God has done for you. And that man understood what Jesus is doing is what God is doing. Really, really interesting. So the question then is, what do we learn from this? One of the questions that the children in Africa asked was, when Jesus says it is going to be more tolerable for Tyre and Sidon than for the cities of Israel in the final judgment, what does he mean by saying it's going to be tolerable for Tyre and Sidon? In the same context, for Sodom and Gomorrah are going to come through the judgment better than Capernaum and Nazareth and Chorazin, the local towns. So I tried to explain what a hyperbole is, an extreme statement. What's interesting is, as I've listened to sermons about connecting with Jesus, about finding life in him, about knowing who he is, the hyperboles are taken as absolute and literal rules, laws. That's the only way of following Jesus. Walk away from your job. Leave your family. Sell everything you own. Cut your right hand off if it causes you to sin. Gouge your eye. Those kinds of things become in a context of the extreme to explain the intensity of the truth. And I think what's fascinating is there are a number of people to whom Jesus says, don't follow me. Don't get up and leave your job. Don't walk away from your family. Don't sell everything you own and give it away. The individuals to whom he said those specific commands, that was an issue for them. If they were part of this grand team, Jesus lived in Capernaum, and most of the early disciples that are called, Peter and Andrew, James and John, were fishermen in that community. It was not a big community, maybe 1,500, 2,000 people. Jesus knew who he was calling. When he walked up to the tax collector's booth and spoke to Levi, Matthew, and said, leave what you're doing and follow me, that was in a context of relationship that Jesus had and knowledge of who that man was and why he could do that action of getting up and walking out of the tax booth to follow him. But what Jesus says to everyone else is not what he's saying to you. I think the one single lesson, the one single thing to learn is that Jesus will have a calling for you. And it's not necessarily going to be exactly the same in the same terms as he calls other people, or even everyone. Now, one of the struggles with that is, are there then no universals? My buddy Mike and I did a podcast this week on Wednesday. And one of the ideas that I had is kind of odd. I haven't developed this entirely yet. But a very helpful practice is to add to any universal in your mind, for me. That changes how you present truth. It's difficult because does that mean there's nothing that applies to everyone? But in these days of incredibly intense political and social issues, to be able to say, here's a stand for me. This is true for me. This is where I am. This is how God is working in my life. These are the standards that I hold. In Romans 14, Paul speaks specifically not to the world, but to the church, which was quite adept at criticizing everyone else for how they weren't living up to what the church had understood, or individuals in the church had understood. And he says to them, don't criticize a person who is serving God. That person is God's servant, not yours. And so where you have learned, what you have gained, how far you have come, what your story is not somebody else's story, and it's also not somebody else's truth. That becomes really, really a tough challenge, except it's the issue of judgmentalism and condescension. I've come farther, I know more, this is what I'm doing, so what applies to me also must apply to you. And the scripture over and over and over says, no. God is working with each person, where they're starting from, where they are, and where they're going. And what I think is quite fascinating is, I read 4 or 5 passages where Jesus says, come and follow me, but that's not a universal requirement. He also says to one man and to others, just stay put. Stay where you are. Tell your story and tell what God has done. And that's our lesson. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, the challenge we have within the church is we think when we've discovered an answer that we have to give the answer to everyone right off the bat. That what applies to me must be universal and apply to everyone. It seems so weird, so counterintuitive, that over and over Jesus says, come follow me, come follow me, come follow me. Get up and walk out on your commitments, your family, your life, and follow me. But to a man who begged to do that very thing, he said, no. Stay here, go back to your family. Tell what happened. That's all I'm asking you to do. You don't have to be a missionary. You don't have to become a pastor. You don't have to become a preacher. What you ask is for us to listen really carefully to you, not to the world, not to the other members of the family of the church. What are you saying to us? How do we tell our story with you? So speak in a way that we are able to hear. And we'll do our best to live according to your way. In Jesus' name we pray.